say and fall like lightning. I saw darkness run for cover, but the miracle that I just can't get over. My name is registered in heaven. I believe in signs and wonders. I have resurrection power. Yes, I do. Still the miracle that I just can't get over. My name is registered in heaven. Yeah, my praise belongs to you forever. Oh, this is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify why Jesus Christ the righteous. Sons and daughters, bought with blood and washed in water. Sing the praises of the Spirit, Son and Father. Our God will finish what He started. Yes, our God will finish what He started. Oh, this is my testimony.
Everyone, my name is Abby Borja and I'm a member of WLCM Main since day one. So before the pandemic, I am an owner of an events company. I organize both corporate events and social events, the weddings, the debuts, and the birthday parties. And I also do on the side modeling and event hosting. But as you all know, because of the pandemic, this global crisis, everything changed. And one of the most affected industries in the entire world is my industry, which is events. So I had to think of other ways on how to earn because I am also the breadwinner of the family. And I have two siblings. They already have children and they don't have work. So I know that I needed to support them. And so I pray to God and I keep on declaring and claiming the promises that He has spoken to me. And that promises, He said that the blameless will spend their days under the Lord's care. Their inheritance will endure forever. In times of disaster, you will not be there. In days of famine, you will enjoy plenty. And so I keep on reminding myself of the promises of God. I keep on telling myself that God is faithful, that He will see me through. And true enough, indeed, that promise is now my reality. And so during those times that I've been praying, I was doing my devotion, my client of mine contacted me. He's a Chinese and apparently he has connections from China. And he told me that he can supply all these PPEs, you know, the KN95, the 3-ply face mask, the gloves, the PPEs, and all these medical supplies. And so what I did is, I posted in my timeline and then so many people commented and ordered from me. And also my clients from event industry, which I catered before, also contacted me. And these are big people. And so they started to cascade my number to all their colleagues and some of their friends from government, from hospital, even from school. They contacted me and they ordered from me. And so you know what, in a span of 2 to 3 weeks, I had 1 million gross sales. And probably in a span of 2 months, I earned one of the biggest earning of my life, which is more than 1 million. And so I thank God that indeed He is an infinite God with infinite ways on how He can provide for me. And I really praise Him for being true. Being true and showing me that He can come through no matter how much impossibility I find myself in. And also, if I can share to you, I also get one of the biggest breakthrough of my life. I won the case over this developer regarding the condominium unit that I got 4 years ago. And so right now I'm getting a full refund of everything that I paid plus damages and payment for the attorney's fee. You know, in our law, the Masede law, it only requires 50% to be refunded. But you know, because our God is a good God and is a just God and He is for me and never against me, I will be getting the full refund of whatever I paid during those times, because our God is a good, faithful God. So I would like to encourage everyone, whatever you're going through right now, I want you to know that there's power in the name of Jesus and there's healing. And there is breakthrough and there's victory and there's beautiful story that awaits you if you will not just give up. So thank you so much once again. I'm Abby.
Good morning, brothers and sisters in Christ. What a beautiful day it is. Thank you for tuning into our church channel on either Facebook or YouTube and inviting us into your home. I know that today you're excited to give praise to the Lord and listen to His word. But before that, let me share to you a story in the Bible that I always go to for encouragement. Are you familiar with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Today, I'm going to highlight their response to Nebuchadnezzar when they were confronted about their disobedience in bowing down to the golden idol. Daniel chapter 3, verse 17 to 18 says, "If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God whom we serve is able to save us. He will rescue us from your power, your majesty. But even if He doesn't, we want to make it clear to you, your majesty, that we will never serve your gods or worship the gold statue you have set up." So these three men were thrown into the furnace, bound and fully dressed. And to the ruler's astonishment, when he sees the furnace, there are four men walking freely, unbound, instead of three, and he notes that the fourth one looks like a god. After that, Nebuchadnezzar gave praise to God and issued another decree that anyone who speaks ill of this god, the god of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, will be cut into pieces and their houses will be destroyed. When Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego told Nebuchadnezzar that God is able to deliver them from his punishment, it speaks largely of their faith. But what amazes me is what they said next, that even if the Lord do not save them from the fire, they will never bow down to the golden idol or worship the gods Nebuchadnezzar served. It does just not speak of their faith and conviction, but of obedience of God's decree, even in the face of death. My friend, what I'm trying to say to you today is, let us always hold on to God's words and promises, submit and obey, and He will make His presence known during the time when we need Him the most. But most of all, let us be faithful still, even if He doesn't show. It does just not speak of their faith and conviction, but of obedience to God's decree, even in the face of death. My friend, what I'm trying to say today is, let us always hold on to God's words and promises. Submit and obey, and He will make His presence known during the time we need Him the most. But most of all, let us be faithful still, even if He doesn't show up. I ask that you prepare your hearts and your minds as we are about to worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords.
Come on, church, let us praise the Lord. Jesus is alive. Hallelujah! Woo!
Risen, He's risen, forever glorified. Risen, He's risen, King Jesus, King Jesus is alive.
Everybody praise the Lord.
Whoa, oh, oh, hallelujah.
Whoa, whoa.
is risen. Hallelujah. Woo! We give you praise, the Lord God. We love you, Jesus. Amen and amen. Hallelujah.
This is a Behold, I have heard a thousand stories of war. They think you're like, but I've heard a tender whispers of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. I can hardly think of
you. Call me
deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still into love.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. You are our cornerstone. Come on, church. Let's worship Him. Hallelujah.
Whoa.
put our trust in you, Lord Jesus.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
Yes, Lord, you are Lord of all. Hallelujah.
When darkness seems to hide His ways, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within your veil.
Strong in the same. Yesterday, today, and forever. You are worthy to be praised. We love you, Lord.
Let the King of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, He is my song. Let the King of my heart be the shadow where you're good. Oh, you are good. You're good. Oh, you are good. You're good. Oh, you are good. You're good. Oh, let the King
you.
Amen. Come on, let us shout, God is good. Hallelujah. All the time, God is good. We thank you, Lord, once again for this wonderful day that we are all together, Lord God. And now we are ready, Lord, to listen to your words of life. Lord, prepare our hearts, O God. Prepare our minds, O Lord, that we may listen, Lord God, with an obedient heart, O Lord. Bless our pastor. Bless, anoint his lips. And Lord God, and may your words of life this morning be like a two-edged sword, that it will pierce into our hearts, O Lord God, and change us from the inside out. Thank you, Lord God, for our pastor. Bless him, O Lord God, and also bless your people. All the glory and praise, we give it back to you. In Jesus' mighty name, and all of God's people shout, Amen.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome once again to another beautiful Sunday. Welcome to Words of Life. For those of you attending for the first time, we're so glad that you are here with us to join us, you know, for a time of worship and to listen to a very, very important word. But before that, I want to welcome everyone, including those of you that are members of this church. Welcome, and I pray that you are all in good health, that the joy of the Lord is filling you right now, that you had a wonderful time of worship together with our worship team. And so we're glad that you are here with us. We want you to know that we in the leadership, we love you, we miss you, and we are constantly praying for you. Amen. Praise God. Now, before we get into the Word, this is Teachers Appreciation Month, and so we would like to be able to appreciate our teachers, particularly those who are with our kids' church online. And they do a very, very challenging and difficult work ministry because everything is online. They're not actually in front of the children. And so they're beginning to understand the challenges of online ministry. But Sunday after Sunday, they are here to not only entertain, but more importantly, to impart to all of our children. And so we just want to recognize them at this time. So let me give you, let me introduce to you our teachers, beginning with Ann Andutan, Dara Kaagoy, Jay De Rosales, Mapol Lifong, Joy Isidenio, Donna Magmanlak, Lizelle Mendoza, CJ Munoz, Lynn Monzon, Eunice Panganiban, Judith Sanyano, Carol Tamayo, and Shelo Taniedo. So to all of our Kids Church online teachers, a big congratulations to all of you. And of course, in behalf of the ministry and all of the parents, thank you so much for your dedication, your hard work, your enthusiasm, you know, and even just doing this Sunday after Sunday after Sunday. Thank you so much. Now, together with our teachers, we said last week and the week before that, that another group that we highly value in this church are our care group leaders. Now, apparently, we discovered that there were two more care group leaders that we did not mention. So we'd like to take the time to mention their names now and offer and just express our gratitude. And these are to Miguel Hing and Samantha Serrano. So once again, to all of our care group leaders, thank you so much for your dedication as well, meeting with your different care groups. And I know that there are quite a number of you that have more than one care group that you meet with every week. Some as much even as five or even more care groups in a week. And really, thank you so much for your work. And for those of you that are still not part of a care group, may I encourage you, be part of a care group. You don't know what you're missing in terms of your own spiritual growth and the support that you probably don't realize you need especially when you go into times of trial, times of trouble, difficult situations. Your care group is like your second family that you can run to, text them, get in touch with them, ask them for help, prayer, you know, and all that stuff like that. Being discipled is an indispensable and not optional part of your Christian journey. Okay, so if you are not yet part of a care group, please join one. Get in touch with Pastor Yoli Iriman. You can PM her on Facebook Messenger and just let her know. Or even down here, just say, I'm not part of a care group. I would like to be part of one. If you are a member of Words of Life, then you should be part of a care group. But for those of you that are joining us, you're already members of other churches, but you still just want to listen to this, you are most welcome. But of course, you are not obligated to join our care group. You should join a care group in your own church. Amen? Okay, so having said that, I do want to get into this word. I know that many of you were blessed. I just received so many comments last week, and actually not just last Sunday, but even during the week, of how blessed you were by our study in, or our look into the book of Esther. And so we are continuing that, and I'm pretty sure we will go again next week on this, because there are just so many things that God is showing me in the book of Esther. But today, I'm especially excited. Again, I always say that, but I'm especially excited because of something that the Lord showed me, which is really an insight and a relevant word, a now word for our situation, our what we are facing today. Not this pandemic, but as we have entered into the year 5781, okay? And even as we prepare to enter 2021, I have something to say about that as well. So let me give you the title of this message, and then we're going to pray. I entitled this, The Esther Anointing, and I gave a subtitle, A Word for Such a Time as This. Okay, let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you so much, Lord, that you guide us prophetically. You guide us so that we will know, not only will we know what to do, but we will know what to tell others that they ought to do as well. And so you've given us that anointing, Lord, and we thank you for that. And so, Father, even now, anoint my lips as I share this word. Let it come forth true and in the spirit that you desire, O Lord. At the same time, I ask for your anointing to be upon everyone that is listening. Give them ears to hear and hearts to understand. A spirit of revelation, O Lord, to come upon each one that they might truly understand what is happening in the spiritual realm and how it will manifest into the natural. We declare this, Lord. We ask for your grace and your guidance, because only you can lead us the way you do. This is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Praise God. Okay, one more time. The title, The Esther Anointing. And I subtitled this, A Word for Such a Time as This. Now, as we have entered into the new year, starting September 18, 2020, as you know, in the Hebraic calendar, this is the timing of God, not our Gregorian calendar, although every so often he will use our Gregorian calendar as well. But it's more because the Gregorian calendar at some junctures coincides with what God is doing as he goes through the timing of the Hebraic calendar. And we're going to see a little bit of that a little bit later this morning. Now, as we entered into the new year, and that was the Feast of Trumpets, September 18, 2020, if you will recall that, okay, there was a shift in the spiritual atmosphere, a change in the spiritual realm. And I know that many of you sensed that. But of course, the question is, I sensed something, some of you are probably saying, I sensed a change, but I'm not sure what exactly is happening. What is God doing? I just sensed it in my spirit, but I have no clue as to what the Spirit of the Lord is doing at this time. Well, that's what this message is all about. Okay, so let's start with Isaiah 42 verse 9. And this is what the Lord says. Behold, the former things have come to pass. So that means everything in the past that God promised, up to this day has already happened, and now new things I declare. And that's what this message is about. Before they spring forth, I tell you of them. In other words, God doesn't want to leave us in the dark. He says, I'm doing a new thing, and before I even begin that, I'm going to speak to my prophets. I'm going to speak to my watchmen. I'm going to speak to my intercessors. And I'm going to reveal to them what I am doing in the spiritual realm. So I give praise to God that He has given us insight into these spiritual matters. I think it's not accidental that God, you know, just led me to look at this narrative in the book of Esther. And it's, you know, it's not like I was praying and the Lord says, go into the book of Esther. I kind of just stumbled into it, you know, in Tagalog, it's called chamba, you know. But as I started reading the book of Esther, something stirred in my spirit. And so I started listening to other teachers that have teachings on the book of Esther. I started picking up a few pointers here and there, trying to sew them together, and then seeking from the mind of God and the Spirit of God, what is your message to us, Lord? You know, and so I just want to start off by saying that I've listened to some prophets as well, and just to get confirmation of what I think the Spirit of God was telling me. And it was such a joy and a sense of relief that when I started listening to these prophets that I esteem, it seems like we're all on the same page. And so this is good confirmation for me, especially because I'm not a prophet, although I believe I am prophetic. This ministry is prophetic. We've got some watchmen in this ministry, and that's always good. Amen. So what is the Lord telling us? Isaiah 53:19 says, behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a road in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. So God has started a supernatural work, and that's the theme of our year, right? Supernatural outcomes. God has started a supernatural work in our midst, and so there is this God shift that is happening in the spiritual realm. And this passage that we just read in Isaiah 53 says that God is going to move supernaturally. Things that were impossible, like roads in the wilderness, rivers in the desert. I mean, what kind of wilderness has roads? That's why it's called wilderness. It's wild. There are no roads. There is no path to follow. You got to make your own path. And there are no rivers in the desert. But what God is saying is, I'm going to lead you. I will make a path in the wilderness. So even though you are going in uncharted territory, and that's really what this is, uncharted territory, I will show you the way to go. And I will sustain you by allowing rivers to come your way in this desert that you are going through. The desert is a place where it's very difficult to navigate because you don't really have landmarks. And what he's saying is there's going to be a river. Follow the river, because river always speaks of life. River always speaks of provision and sustenance and blessing. And so that's what this is all about. God is moving us into uncharted territory, but we don't have to be afraid. God will lead us. Amen? And God's people said, amen. Praise God. So really what he has done and what he's doing here is this. He has placed all the pieces on the board, as it were. All the pieces are on the board. Now everything is set. And he's about to start a new thing. And this is really what excites me. So you're going to begin to see these things manifest, these spiritual moves of God manifest in the natural, I believe, within the next several weeks and months. Okay? Now, I don't want to give you exactly like 3 months or 6 months or whatever, but within the next few months, you're going to start seeing, and even weeks, you're going to start seeing God moving so mightily in our midst. So, the question, of course, that we want to answer is, what is the Lord showing us through the Esther narrative? So, let's get into this. First and foremost, as we have seen, as we saw last week, okay, there is a shift from Queen Vashti to Queen Esther. Do you remember that? Okay, if you were not with us last week, it'll be good. After you listen to this message, go back to last week's message and just listen to it so you understand what's happening. So there is this shift that's happening. Queen Vashti, well, she was the queen. Vashti was the queen of Persia. And because of a series of events, she was dethroned. And after another series of events, Esther took over and she became the next queen. And that's what we talked about last week. Now, there is this shift. So as that happened in the natural, it's happening again in the spiritual. Now remember, a few weeks ago, we talked about wineskins. Remember that? We talked about wineskins and that God wants to pour out new wine into the church, but the wineskins have to be changed first. It is necessary for the wineskins to change so that the new wine will not be lost. The new wine will not be spilled, as it were. This new move of God, this new anointing, this new harvest. And what we were talking about is that the new wineskin God is talking about is the culture of the church, the mindset, the paradigms of the church. We need to shift to a kingdom paradigm. And there are many churches that have already started doing that. You know, in our church, we started talking about the kingdom way back as far as the 90s. And so a lot of the people now just have an idea of this kingdom mentality. Of course, we've got some new members since then. But developing a kingdom mindset is so crucial for this new anointing to be able to not just stay, but to flourish. Okay? So Vashti represents the old way of things, the old way of thinking, the old way of doing things, the old protocols. And that's done away with. It is over. It is finished. She was taken out of the way. And there is a change that is happening. And so before this change, between Vashti and Esther, the king did something very, very wise, I believe. And we see it in Esther chapter 1, verse 13. This is what it says. Since it was customary for the king to consult experts in matters of law and justice, very important, okay? He spoke with a wise man who understood the times. So the king turned to the wise men who were experts in law and justice, but more than that, they understood the times. And that is very, very crucial. Today, these are the watchmen and the prophets of the Lord. These are the people of God who are sensitive to the Spirit of God. They're pretty much like the sons of Issachar. You will remember that he said this in 1 Chronicles chapter 12, I believe, about the sons of Issachar who understood the times. And many years ago, those of you that were with us way back then, like 2 decades ago now, the Lord spoke to us and said that He was placing the anointing of Issachar upon this ministry. And that really excites me because the sons of Issachar understood the times and they told Israel what to do. So these are those who are sensitive to the Holy Spirit. They see beyond the natural. They're not moved by what they see in the natural because they see beyond the natural into the spiritual realm. And the natural is secondary. It's not unimportant, but it's secondary because the spiritual realm is not only more real, it is a lot more powerful than the natural realm and exerts a tremendous amount of influence into the natural realm. So they see beyond this, and so these are the men and women of God who see into the natural realm, are sensitive to the Spirit of God, and they have authority when they speak. They have the authority in the spiritual realm to call in a new law. Okay, now please understand me when I say a new law. That means a new way of doing justice, so that justice will prevail in the land. Now, I'll explain that in a little bit. I want you to notice first, okay, the names of the provinces in which this narrative took place. First is Persia. And Persia means the land of divisions. It means to split or divide. Interesting, isn't it? And then there's the province of Media or Median, because this was the Medo-Persian Empire. So Media means strife and place of judgment. Now, this is where the story begins to take place. And there was so much strife and division in the land. And when we try and apply that today, even here in the Philippines, there is so much strife and division here in our land. I mean, even just in the natural, you see that we are a very divided people. We are very territorial, you know, between the Ilocanos and the Visayans, the Tagalogs, the Mindanaoans, and so on and so forth. There's just like you and us, you know, and even between people and government, there is a divide. You know, it's like the government says, and so they say, and so we see them as something separate from us. And then many times we think that the government, well, they're not really thinking of us. You know, they're there to enrich themselves. And I suppose to a large extent, there is truth to that. Okay. So there is so much strife and division here in the Philippines, but this is true also beyond our borders, in many other nations. And all you have to do is just listen to the news. Listen to the news, both domestically and abroad, foreign news. The place is just, the nations of this world are filled with strife. You've got, for example, the most pressing issue, coronavirus, right? And how people feel about coronavirus. Some say the whole thing is fake. Some people say that it's not dangerous to warrant all of these quarantines. And some say that this is really lethal, stay at home. And so the people are divided, and there is strife between how, you know, how, for example, this is being handled, or maybe I should say mismanaged. And then, of course, there are wars happening all over the place. Even now, as I speak, in Afghanistan and other parts of the world, really, wars that are happening. Crime rate is at an all-time high. Corruption. In every sector and level of society here in the Philippines and abroad as well. This is not something that is just peculiar to the Philippines, but everywhere in the world. And economic upheavals and manipulations. There are some things I can say about that, but I'll choose to be silent first for now. And who are the preachers of fear? Remember, media means fear as well. You know, so when you put the Medo-Persian Empire, it is an empire of fear and splitting up and violence and so on and so forth. And so who are these preachers of fear? Well, we saw that one of the provinces is Media. Now, I know that Media was a province in that region, but there's another province today called Media that rules the airwaves. And so with all due respect to the honorable journalists, and there are some, the media is one of the more influential preachers of fear. They propagate fear. I mean, there's a way to effectively communicate even bad news, but when you thrive on the fear of people, that's wickedness. And that is my opinion on that. So many of us, we complain about what we hear. It's all bad news everywhere we listen, and yet we listen. We listen. I have chosen to just, for the most part anyway, stop listening to the news. Now, we still need to, okay? But I don't listen to it every day. And I just try and go to different places on the internet and just get headlines. And if I'm interested, I'll read a little bit more, but nothing more than that. But when you're listening to on television, you don't have control over what they're going to say. And so it's just hard to stop them sometimes, okay? But that's me. Okay. So we complain about what we hear, but we still listen day after day after day. Now, let's look at some of the characters in this narrative of Esther. We said that the move of God is a shift from Vashti to Esther. So let's look at Vashti. The name Vashti is an interesting name. It actually means beautiful. It means beautiful. It means beautiful woman. But another meaning to the name Vashti means drunkenness. And the idea being drunk with beauty. Now this speaks of worldly beauty, a seductive beauty, a lustful kind of beauty, with much emphasis on physical beauty. And isn't that the case today? Even now, in our world today, there is still so much emphasis on physical beauty. We don't even go out that much, not as much as we used to, but there are still commercials, both on TV, the internet, and everywhere on beauty and makeup and body shape and what have you. There is a tremendous, it's a multi-billion dollar industry. And I'm not against physical beauty, by the way, okay? But sometimes we overemphasize it, even to the point of neglecting spiritual beauty. And that is not right. So that's Vashti. Now let's look at Esther. Esther means star, and she is the star of this narrative, of this story in the book of Esther, under her name. But her name was originally Hadassah. Now, Hadassah means myrtle tree. And I wasn't so sure, like, okay, myrtle tree, so her name is a tree. Now, what about the myrtle tree? And it's actually a very, very interesting tree. The myrtle tree is a beautiful evergreen tree. That means it is always, it's always fresh. There's always a freshness about it, regardless of season. And it emits a fragrance more beautiful than any other tree. In fact, that's what it's known for, the fragrance of the myrtle tree. And I believe that this speaks of the church. This speaks of the beauty of the church. When we look at what this is, see, the myrtle tree is beautiful. And it speaks of the church in that it reflects the beauty of the one who makes all things beautiful in its time. Amen? Praise God. It is also evergreen, always fresh, always, it's not seasonal. There is a constancy to the myrtle tree. That regardless of the season, it is always fresh. It is always green. The flowers are blooming. And so, like the church, which is ready in season and out of season. That's who you are, my friend, if you are part of the church. But at the same time, it emits a fragrance that is more beautiful, than any other tree. And that, I think, is what really characterizes the church, because we are the fragrance of God in Christ. We diffuse the fragrance of God through the knowledge of Christ. Amen? And so, that's who Esther is. Now, Vashti is the old way, and the old way is passing away. There is a shift. You'll notice that even with all of this quarantine right now, not too many people put makeup on anymore. Why? Because we don't go out. Why put on makeup if you'll just stay at home, right? And so there is now a shifting that is taking place. And where physical beauty and how we look and fixing our hair and everything like that. Well, for those of us that come out on camera like this, we still take the time, of course, to beautify ourselves. I don't think you'd enjoy watching this service if my hair were unkempt and, you know, I look like I just woke up and I'm just wearing a t-shirt and stuff like that. So it's still important, but it's not that important. Amen. It's not that important. We are focusing now on the spiritual beauty. Now let's look at the villain in this story, the antagonist. And it's Haman. Actually, when we are introduced to Haman, they gave his full title. Haman, the son of Hamadatha, the Agagite. Now, This whole name, Haman, son of Hammedatha, the Agagite, means a multitude of noise. He who troubles the law, a flame and violent rooftop. So when you look at all those names, Haman, son of Hammedatha, and the Agagite, okay, that's his tribe, from the family of Agag or Agag. It means a multitude of noise. He who troubles or perverts or changes the law, a flame and violent rooftop. Now, that's very interesting because rooftop speaks of covering. You have the roof over your head. And so it speaks of your covering. This is the picture of our nation today. There is violence. We saw the name. It's a multitude of noise. There's violence. It's a violent rooftop. And so it shows that the umbrella over us right now is violence and corruption. The one who troubles the law or takes the law into their own hands. The one who perverts the law. We've had so many laws change over the last 10, 20 years. Not just here in the Philippines. But you know, here in the Philippines, we are so closely at the heels of the United States. And so a lot of their laws affect us more than we are willing to admit, perhaps. And so many things that happen in the United States actually have both a direct and indirect effect here on our nation. And so recently, these laws that were changed that allows for certain kinds of marriages and abortion and all these things are affecting us. And these laws have been changed and perverted, but I believe that that's God is bringing a change into that. Even here in the Philippines, God is bringing a change in that. But we see corruption from the lowest to the highest echelons in Philippine society. And it is disturbing. Where the wheels of justice grind ever so slowly, not giving justice, especially to the poor, where justice favors the rich. Laws are being passed favoring the wealthy. And the antidote to the Haman spirit is the Esther anointing. And this is where it gets exciting. What is that Esther anointing? Esther chapter 4, this is what it says. For if you remain completely silent, at this time, relief and deliverance will arise for the Jews from another place. But you and your father's house will perish. This is Mordecai speaking to Hadassah or to Esther. Yet who knows whether you have come to the kingdom for such a time as this? Now, what is this Esther anointing? Let me show it to you by what Esther did. But let me just say something here very quickly. There are certain things I'm about to say now that I believe is God's word, a now word. It's a kairos word, an appropriate word, a divinely appointed word for you and me at this time. And what Mordecai told Esther is this. If you remain silent at this time, God will still bring deliverance to the people here in our nation, in the Philippines. And I know those of you watching from other countries, God is also, this is not just for the Philippines. I'm speaking to you right now in your own nations and cities and towns and provinces. God is saying, I am doing a new thing that is global. And so this word is for you as well, even if you are not in the Philippines, or even if you are a Filipino in another country that's watching this right now. And we need to do our part. And in a few moments, I'm going to say what that is. And let me just show this. The Bible says, yet who knows, Mordecai said, yet who knows whether you have come into the kingdom for such a time as this. Some of you have been born again into the kingdom of God within the last 5 years. Just within the last 5 years. Let me tell you something. God has brought you into this kingdom of God, into His kingdom for such a time as this. And you are part of it. This is not just for the seasoned believers like myself, who I've been serving God since 1983 and in full-time ministry since 1987. But for those of you that have come into the kingdom, you have come into the kingdom not accidentally, but for such a time as this. So, what is that Esther anointing? Let me show you how it manifests by what Esther did. First, we fast and pray. Or we pray and fast. In Esther chapter 4, verse 16, this is what Esther said. Go, gather all the Jews who are present in Shushan and fast for me. Neither eat nor drink for 3 days, night or day. My maids and I will fast likewise. And so I will go to the king, which is against the law. There's a changing of the law. And if I perish, I perish. This is a time of consecration for the body of Christ here in the Philippines, as well as in other nations. A time of consecration. To consecrate oneself means to devote oneself fully to the work of God, at least in our context. This is a time of intense prayer and fasting. Now, I know for those of us that are Words of Life, we just got out of a 21-day fast just last month. We started in August, it went into September, and now it sounds like I'm calling for a fast again. Well, I am. Now, but equally important to the fast is the intense prayer. A prayer for God to move in every level of society, beginning with the president, our beloved president, all the way down to the Tanod Bayans and to the Kabataang, you know, all the way down to the barangay level. And just everywhere, up to the very households. Pray literally for every household in our nation. We need to do that now, because if we want change, it begins in the heart. It doesn't begin by changing the laws. The laws will change when the hearts change. Because when the heart is made right, then every crooked law will be made right. And I believe that we're going to see that happening over the next few years. There will be changes in our laws that will now be more judicious. It will be more equitable. Where even the poor will receive justice. So, not just 3 days, but over the next 3 months. And so I'm not calling you to fast for 3 months, 90 days, that's a long time, but every so often within this next 3 months, and three is very significant, but over the next 3 months to be fasting and praying, because I believe that God is going to do something significant, something so pivotal. We are at that tipping point, and so we need to tip the scales towards righteousness over unrighteousness, over goodness versus wickedness. Now, 3 is the number of resurrection. We've spoken about that, and many of you know that already. 3 is the number of resurrection, but there is no resurrection without death. There has to be a death. Now, I'm not saying that some people have to die. That's not what I'm talking about, but it calls... The death I'm talking about is a death to the desires of our flesh. Not to the death of desires, because some desires are godly, but to carnal desires, worldly desires, even good desires, but not God desires. It basically, it's a death to worldly pleasures. And it's basically a setting aside of things to focus on the kingdom for the next 3 months. I am calling the church, Words of Life in particular, but to all of you that are watching, to focus on the things of God. Maybe you like to listen to music, all kinds of music. I like to listen to all kinds of music, especially jazz. But just this past several weeks now, I've just been focusing on listening to Christian music where I can worship, I can praise, and even when I'm doing the laundry or cooking or whatever, you know, I just like to listen to Christian music, gospel music, so it feeds my spirit and allows me to become more sensitive to the Spirit of the Lord. And perhaps that's why God is showing us these things now, because of this sensitivity, this consecration that has happened over the last several weeks and moving on over to the next 3 months, 2.5 to 3 months, if we start from September 18, really, so that we can fast and pray for the things of God to happen here. It is basically a refocusing into the things of God. There is a watchman prophet, he, I believe, calls himself a prophet, that I listen to from time to time, Tommy Arayomi, who prophesied specifically for the Philippines just last June. And he said that over the next 3 months, certain things are going to happen in the Philippines, good things that are going to happen to the Philippines. I don't have time to talk about that. You can search for it on the internet. And so at the time that he preached that, I think it was on June 24 when it was uploaded, and he said 3 months, so that would be about September, October-ish, which is right now. And at that time, he didn't even realize about the Feast of Trumpets, that it's the new year, a new season, a new wind, a new anointing, a fresh move of God that is coming upon the church, and in particular here in the Philippines. Now, just because he prophesied good things will happen doesn't mean that it will automatically happen. Just like Elijah, God said that it's going to start raining. And what did Elijah do? He prayed it in. He prayed. He took the classical position of intercession, head between his legs, and he just started to pray it in. It's like birthing a baby into the kingdom. And so here, we've got all these promises of the Philippines once again rising economically, becoming a tourist hub, becoming an economic hub of Asia, which we used to be, by the way, way back in the 60s. But we've lost that through the years. And God is going to restore that once again. God will bring the Philippines in once more into a golden age. I truly believe that with all my heart. But we gotta pray that in, church. We gotta pray that in. Elijah, the Bible says, prayed in, seven times. Amen. He prayed in seven times for something to happen, and it did happen. Amen. Praise God. It did happen. But he had to pray seven times. So we cannot quit. We cannot pull back. We got to press on. And we are at that crucial time, church, a threshold of God's outpouring of new wine into our nation. Praise God. So the first thing that Esther did was fast and pray. Now, the second thing is you need to know who you are. Know who you are. Esther 5 says, now it happened on the third day. Now, look at me for a while, okay? Look at me. It says here, now it happened on the third day. Now, I believe that this third day for us today is the third month. It happened on the third month. Now, that, I believe, will be by about January-ish. And so, as we enter into the new calendar year, as we enter into 2021, I believe that there are certain things that will start happening. This is the year. God put everything in place. He already told Elijah, it's going to rain. But there was not a single cloud in the sky when he said that. But yet God said it, which means all the clouds were in place. It just could not be seen in the natural realm. But in the spiritual realm, there was a storm already. So now it's the same thing. That God has put everything in its proper place, every blessing, every change in the laws of the land, every wrong that will be made right. It's already there. Now, we need to pray it in. Okay? And when is this going to happen? I think, look at this, let's go back, Esther 5. Now it happened when? On the third day. I believe that as we go into the new year 2021, that's when we're going to start seeing things really happening. Okay? Beginnings. Not everything, but the beginnings of change. It might start out very slowly, almost imperceptibly. But But God has already started moving. Amen? That's the good news. So it happened on the third day that Esther put on her royal robes and stood in the inner court of the king's palace, across from the king's house, facing the entrance of the house. Verse 2, so it was, when the king saw Queen Esther standing in the court, that she found favor in his sight. And the king held out to Esther the golden scepter that was in his hand. Then Esther went near and touched the top of the scepter. See, we need to understand that on the third day, the Bible says that Esther put on her royal robe. She understood who she was. Now, she was a peasant girl. But by chapter 5, that was not her identity anymore. She had forgotten that. That's a thing of the past. She's saying, I am no longer this peasant girl that has no access to the king. I'm no longer this peasant girl that is afraid to approach the majesty and the glory of someone so august, someone so awesome, someone that seems to be so far away. Now I am in the palace. I am royalty. I put on my robes of righteousness, the Bible says, and the garments of praise. Hallelujah. Praise God. And we approach our king, the King of Kings, the Lord of Glory, as we enter in knowing who we are. Church, know your royal position in the courts of our King. We have access to the one, the only one that can change our nation and the nations of this world. Put on your royal robes, the robes of righteousness. Put on the garments of praise and enter into his courts with thanksgiving, the Bible says. And as you go in, even though it is unlawful, the Bible says, it is unlawful that the queen should come in unsummoned. But if the king would stretch forth his scepter, that means I accept your presence. I accept your approach. And instead of death, I will show you favor. Church, I want you to understand that we need to be men and women of courage. This is a bride, the bride of Christ, who can approach her king with courage, understanding that we are clothed with the garments of praise. We are clothed with the robes of righteousness dipped in the blood of the slain lamb. And we have access, and we can enter in boldly, it says in the book of Hebrews. We can enter in boldly into the king and bring forth our petitions. Bring forth our petitions to our king. Let us now begin to cry out for our land. Those of you in other nations, fall down on your face. Come before the king in your robes of righteousness and your garments of praise, and cry out for your land, for your country, for your president, for your prime minister, for your king. Oh, that righteousness may envelop the land, and that our nations might become the kingdoms of our King. Amen. See, understand that we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Government is not our enemy. The people in government, they are not our enemy. But we do wrestle against principalities and powers in heavenly realms, in dark places. And that we realize that there are weapons forged against us. But the good news is they will not prosper. Amen. And any lying tongue that rises up against you, the Lord Almighty will silence. He will silence, praise God. Hallelujah. See, Esther approached the king, understanding the protocol of the kingdom. How did she approach the king? First, she approached in humility. She fasted and prayed. She didn't say, well, you know, I'm the wife. I can go in anytime. No, you can't. No, you can't. You can't come in anytime, and you can't come in any way. But see, we have that access. We can come in anytime, but some people don't know how to approach our king. But she came in humility, first. Second, she came in full assurance. She wore her royal robe. She understood who she was, and yet she remained humble. And that must be our posture. And number three, she entered in boldness. There was that humility, but there was a boldness. She stood in the inner court. She didn't crawl in. She didn't whimper her way in. She stood in the inner court. There was that quiet assurance, just like the church. She pressed beyond the outer courts into the inner courts. Amen. And she worshiped. She worshiped. The Bible says, I will enter his gates with thanksgiving. And she praised. And I will enter his courts with praise. Listen carefully. Let me give you this passage in Luke chapter 4. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim that captives will be released, that blind will see, that the oppressed will be set free, and that the time of the Lord's favor has come. See, I believe that many in the body of Christ are going to receive their deliverance this year. Listen, I am prophesying this to you in the name of Jesus. Many captives are going to be set free. Many will begin to become so sensitive to the Spirit of God. Even now, God is speaking to you. As you listen to my words, God is putting a witness in your heart. It's like you're saying, yes, yes, yeah, there's an excitement in you. That's the Spirit of God, my friends. So many are going to become even more sensitive. And for those of you that are not sensitive, you will enter into a place of sensitivity to the Holy Spirit. You won't have to guess your way through life. God will guide you where the Spirit of the Lord says, this is the way, walk ye in it. And this is the best part. In Luke chapter 4, it says that the time of the favor of the Lord has come. God's favor is going to be on, listen to me, God's favor is going to be on you. You know what? I want you to say this after me. Say this. God's favor is on me right now. Go ahead, say it. God's favor is on me right now. Say it one more time. Come on, let's say it together. God's favor is on me. Point to yourself. On me right now. And God's people said, amen and amen. And why? Why is God's favor on you? Not just so that you can have something that you didn't have before. Not just so you can have all the things that you didn't have before. But it's for the purpose of the kingdom. It's the purpose of the kingdom. Let me tell you now, in the name of Jesus, the Spirit of God, our King of Kings, is extending his scepter towards you right now. Psalm 110 says, the Lord will extend your mighty scepter from Zion, saying, rule in the midst of your enemies. And that's the anointing that God is giving to the church. It is a kingly anointing. It is an authoritative anointing. It is an anointing that is filled with the power of his word, so that when we speak, things begin to happen. Remember, this is the year of the mouth, or the year of the word of God, where as we speak God's word, things begin to happen. It is not an accident. It is not an accident. You got to go back and listen to that message that I spoke about 5781. And the third thing that Esther did, first, fast and pray. Second, know who you are. And third, celebrate. Celebrate. Look at this. Esther chapter 5, verse 4. Oh, I love this. If it pleases the king, replied Esther, let the king, together with Haman, come to a banquet I have prepared for him. Now, it's interesting. Haman's plot to kill all the Jewish people had not yet been made known to the king. Only Esther knew about this. Haman, his wife, and Mordecai, of course, because it reached Mordecai. And before the plot could be exposed, and before the antagonist or the villain could be taken out of the way, what does she do? She prepares a banquet. She celebrates even before she sees the victory with her physical eyes. That, my friends, is faith. That, my friends, is how you and I are going to get our victory, by faith. And so we celebrate. The Lord, the Bible says, will prepare a table for you. When and where? in the presence of your enemies. That means the enemies have not yet been vanquished. But before they're vanquished, we're going to have a feast first. Amen? So yes, and I bring this to a close. What are we called to do? First, fast and pray. Fast and pray. For the next 3 months, church, I'm calling you to fast and pray. Fast when you are led. Fast for how long or short, or in however way you desire, as you are led by the Spirit of God. But pray. Pray for our nation. Pray for our government. Pray for our government leaders, our spiritual leaders. Pray for the prophets in the land, for the watchmen in our land. In the name of Jesus, pray for them. And then, don't forget who you are to the King. Pray with boldness. Pray with courage. But pray with humility as we approach our King. Because He will extend His scepter to you. And as we do this, there will come a time when we will celebrate. I don't know when yet. This is a time for consecration, a time for fasting and prayer. But before, even before we see the victory, remember, even in the story of Esther, they finished the fasting and prayer, and then she finished it with a feast. So we're going to do the same. We're going to take the principles that we have learned from the story of Esther for the next 3 months. Fast and pray and intercede and come before our God in full assurance. And when that ends, even before we see any change coming to our nations, we're going to celebrate. Amen? We're going to celebrate. Now, as I close, I want to say this. I truly believe that we are at a crucial point, but this is not the time to prematurely celebrate. This is not the time to just focus on ourselves, our blessing, our family. I'm not saying don't do it. What I am saying is let's give a little bit more emphasis on the kingdom of God. Let's be a little bit more committed, a little bit more prayerful, a little bit more worshipful, a little bit more mindful of the things of God. Spend a little bit more time in the Word than we normally do over the next 3 months. And I believe that when this time is over, we will see things begin to happen. As we enter into the year 2021, we will start to see things happen. It will happen. I'm not sure if God will do it quickly or slowly, but things will begin to move if we pray. And so I pray that we're going to do that even now. I pray that this word, this is not a word to just excite you. This is a word that is calling us into action. This is not a word to just make you feel good. This is a call to action, church. A call to action. Next week, if God allows, we will continue with our story in Esther. I know you were blessed by last Sunday's message, and I know that you are desiring more. I am desiring more as well as I dive more and more into the book of Esther and seeing just the beauty of this book. But this message is a call to action. And so I pray that we really take this word seriously. We don't need, well, let's take it seriously. And so I want to start right now. We're going to pray right now. I'm going to ask you right now where you are, whether you're seated, standing, or on your knees, any position you want to take, but we're going to start our time of intercession for our nation. And for those of you that are from other nations, pray for the nation that you are in. Even if you're an immigrant, even if you know you some of you are in other countries, but you're Filipinos, pray for your country, but pray also for the Philippines. And for those of you that are from other countries, residing in other countries, but you have a home country, pray for both countries, where you're residing and where your roots are. And we're going to do that right now. Come on, let's pray right now. Let's pray right now. Father, oh, we worship you, we praise you, we honor you. You are the King of Kings. You are the mover of nations. You are the God who puts kings in their thrones and deposes them and takes them off. You are the only one that can bring a true and lasting change to a household as well to a nation. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus, we lift you, our nation, right now. Right now, go ahead, name the nation that you are in right now. Father, for us, it's in the Philippines. We lift up to you the Philippines right now, and we cry out for mercy, O God. Have mercy on our country. Have mercy on our nation. Have mercy on the Philippines, O Lord. In the name of Jesus Christ, have mercy. You have tested us. You have tried us. You have allowed many things to happen. But now you have put your foot down. This is the time for justice. This is the time for righteousness. This is the time to right the wrongs. This is the time, Lord, where you will begin to change certain things that have been wicked and unjust, and put righteousness, O Lord. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus, touch our government officials right now. I'm not asking that you change them with another person, but we're asking that you change their hearts and you change their minds, O Lord, whether they know you or not, but that they will start doing what is right, O Lord, in the name of Jesus. Just like it says in Micah chapter 6, verse 8, O Lord, that we might love justice and that we might walk before our God all the days of our lives, to walk by faith. In the name of Jesus, we pray that over our nation and the leaders of our nation. We pray for our spiritual leaders, O Lord, the pastors, the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the teachers, that they might rise up with greater righteousness, to make a stand for what is right, to be unafraid, O Lord, to follow you and you alone, O Lord, regardless of the consequences, in the name of Jesus, O Lord. And we pray, Father, for the church, that the church would arise right now, Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ. Church, arise. For the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. The anointing of Almighty God is upon you, and the favor of the Lord is now, in the name of Jesus. Father, like Elijah, we pray for rain over our land, rain that speaks of blessing. Let it rain with your favor, rain with your justice, rain with righteousness, rain with your glory, rain with your joy, O Lord, rain with your mercy over the land. In the name of Jesus, we come against crime, we come against injustice, we come against the everything that is unrighteous, all forms of gambling and drugs and crime and kidnapping and rape and everything that is demonic and ungodly. In the name of Jesus, we push back. We push back the forces of darkness in the name of Jesus. And we are declaring that we are claiming our rights in this land as children of God. Lord, you put us here in this country, and you put other people in the countries where they are right now, so that wherever the soles of our feet shall tread upon shall become part of the kingdom of God. And so we claim every island in the Philippines in the name of Jesus Christ. We declare that the Philippines belongs to the Lord, that the Philippines belongs to Jesus Christ. We come against every god that is being exalted above the knowledge of Christ, and we pull them down in the name of Jesus. Every wannabe god that poses as God but is not God, in the name of Jesus, we come against that. Every lying spirit, every human being that exalts himself in the place of God, we Father, expose them for the lie that they are, the liars that they are, in the name of Jesus. And we pray, O Lord, that all of these wannabe gods, these humans who pose themselves as gods and spiritual leaders but are just using whips on the backs of your saints, Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray that they might repent of their ways, that they might turn from their wicked ways and turn to you, O Lord, and bring refreshing into the souls of your people, O God, and not more burdens, Lord, because you came to take our burdens, because your burden is light, O God. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus, as we lift up to you the Philippines, we will continue to do this until for the next 3 months, O Lord, and we will see the fruit of our prayers as we begin to fast and pray, enter into your presence boldly, knowing that we have the robes of righteousness and the garments of praise covering us, O Lord, and that we have every right to be in your presence, to intercede for the sake of our nation. And so, Father, that's what we're going to do. And we are expectant because we've got faith. And our faith is not in faith. Our faith is in you, the one who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or even think. And so we know this is a done deal. You told us that this nation will rise again. This nation shall be great again. This nation, the Philippines, will rise again. And so we are declaring that even now. We command, Philippines, arise. Arise even now. Arise even now. In the name of Jesus, arise once more into your rightful place. And so we say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. We receive the answer to this prayer. We declare it is done. But we will continue to pray until we see that cloud in the sky, even if it's only the size of a man's fist. We will pray until we see that cloud. We will pray until we see something happening. And we say thank you. Even now, Lord, we say thank you. We offer to you our thanksgiving because this is a done deal. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen and amen and amen and amen. Wow, praise God. Can you feel that anointing? It's time to rise up. Amen, church? It's time to rise up. Understand your place. Understand your place in the kingdom of God. Because this is a glorious time that God is ushering us into, even as we enter into the year 2021. So, that's it. I believe the Lord has spoken. I believe I've given you everything that the Lord has put in my spirit for this particular service. I know we're a little over time, but I hope you don't mind. But I just really needed to get this out. And so I'm excited. And I am declaring. I'm just going to close in prayer right now. I want you to just lift up your hands before you. Seated, standing, it doesn't matter. But just lift up your hands before you right now in a position of receiving. Because I just sense this anointing to release something into your spirit right now. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray that your anointing will fall upon everyone listening right now. Every child of yours, every born again, blood bought, blood washed, spirit filled son and daughter of yours. In the name of Jesus, I loose your anointing, a new anointing, a fresh anointing, the new wine, O Lord, to your people even now in the name of Jesus. I pray, Father, that we might, every one of us, understand the authority that you have placed upon us, that you have given us royal robes just like Queen Esther. Vashti's gone. Esther is in. A new anointing, a new move, O Lord, and help us to perceive it with our eyes. Behold, indeed, you are doing a new thing. Can we not perceive it? Cause us to perceive it, O God. Cause us to perceive it. So we receive that right now, and we say thank you for it. And now I declare, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord bless you and keep you and make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance over you and give you peace. Shalom. Blessing in every area of your life. Nothing missing, nothing broken. Beginning now. Beginning now. A time of restoration of everything that was taken from you, everything that was stolen from you. The devil will have to return double for your trouble. That is a prophetic word. I just spoke right now. Double for your trouble that is coming your way, and that, Lord, you would take away everything that the devil has placed on us. This heaviness, fear, anxiety, depression, anger, unforgiveness, all of these things. Father, take it away and break every chain that the devil has placed around us, every lie, every deception in the name of Jesus. I declare it over you even now. There is a new freedom that you are going to begin walking into, even for many of you starting today. starting today, I declare it over you even now. Thank you, Lord. We receive it. Come on, say, I receive it. I receive it. We receive it, Lord, even now. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen and amen and amen. Well, what a service we had today. God bless you. Have a glorious and powerful week ahead of you, a week of intercession, a week of prayer, a week for some of you that might start fasting already this week. In the name of Jesus, I declare all of God's goodness over you, even now. In Jesus' name. We'll see you next Sunday. Have a blessed week. God bless you all.
Hi again. Are you blessed by the word this morning? I'm sure we all are. We would like to thank you again for joining us here in our online service. And by the way, if you have answered prayers or testimonies, we would like to hear from you. All you have to do is send us a message on our Facebook page. And for prayer concerns or requests, you can send us a message to our prayer helpline, that is 0905-293-4343. Our prayer warriors will be glad to pray with you. Have a wonderful week. Be blessed and stay blessed. See you guys next week. Take care.